I like using a scope, not because it's a good scope, but because it has no cooling fan, so it's quite quiet. But I'm wondering, how warm does it get inside? It's been running for an hour, and looking at it in infrared, we got about 25 degrees on top, so that's not too bad, but how warm is it inside? And looking at it in infrared, we can tell that the circuit board, this part here, is quite warm, but this looks rather cold. But the problem is, this part here is metal, and it is reflective in infrared, so it just kind of reflects my hand here, which is not as warm as the circuit board. So I can't really get a good infrared reading off of that. So I'm just going to stick some tape on here, which is not infrared reflective. And now with the infrared, we can see this part here is actually quite lit up, so that is quite warm. Now, looking at this close up, in the middle we have 35.5 degrees, which corresponds to basically the masking tape on the heatsink. Below that, we see 42 degrees, and that tells me the PCB below is actually a bit warmer. Now, all this is a little bit blurry, not as sharp as the camera can go, so I can use a little zinc selenite lens, which is actually meant for infrared lasers. And if I hold that in front, that brings it into focus, which gives us more detail. The temperature readings will be less accurate at this point, but doesn't change very much. And looking at this, we've got these bluish pads here, which I guess are supposed to be thermally conductive to the heatsink, but my guess is they're not very good. Okay, it's been on for a while, and hottest appears to be these little chips and this one here. So basically, these two and this one not so much. So I think the thermal conductivity of these pads is not ideal, so it'd be better if they were thinner, so if I made some standoffs to go on here, they wouldn't be so thick anymore. Or I could just make a whole new heatsink. But there's no point in making this heatsink any thicker, because looking at an infrared, it doesn't look like it has any difficulty distributing the heat, it's just the pads are not ideal. Or it occurred to me I could just grind the spacers off of here a bit so that it comes closer to the chips. I still have quite a bit of space before I touch those chips, so I think I can cut away half of these standoffs easily. So these are now down to about 3.2 millimeters, which is to say I took 1.8 millimeters off of them, which means I need to take as much off of these pads. Now, putting this back on, I hope these things are compliant enough that I'll make contact with all the chips. So let's plug it back in and wait. And I'm seeing a warm spot here, which corresponds to basically looking in here, because that's reflecting heat off of this part here. So basically, we can tell that the back of the PCB is getting warm. Yep, the scope is still working. I left this running for 20 minutes now, and looking at it with the infrared camera, we have the heatsink here presently reading 37 degrees and the PCB below it at 40.2. So I can't tell the temperature of the actual chip, but the temperature difference between the PCB and the heatsink is about half of what it was before. I looked up thermal conductivity for gel pads like this, and this one on Amazon is 6 watts per meter Kelvin. And I worked that out if we have an effective area of 5 by 5 millimeter, because the chip doesn't heat evenly, and 1 watt from the chip, which is probably fairly reasonable, we get 6.7 degrees temperature difference. They're basically about 2.5% as conductive as aluminum, so not great. And I was wondering, is my calculation really right? To check my work, I got ChatGPT to do it, and it also says 6.7 degrees. So not great. Don't ever use them on a CPU, but still much better than just air. So imagine we have a reflective body that reflects infrared heat that's being sent to it from other objects, because there's infrared going everywhere. So if this object were radiating heat but reflecting everything that comes to it, it would eventually become cooler. No thermal equilibrium. We know that doesn't happen. And the reason it doesn't happen is if a body is reflective in infrared, it also doesn't emit.
So emissivity and reflectivity always add up to one.
So I wonder what the effect is on this heatsink being a poor radiator of heat. And I can't measure that with infrared, because it just reflects, so I added a temperature sensor on here, which has even got a bit of insulation on it, so it picks up the temperature of the heatsink, not the environment. And I got a computer graphing the temperature over time, so let's plug this guy in again and see how it does. And after a few minutes, we're already about 9 degrees over ambient, but it's going to take a while to reach equilibrium. Been sitting there for an hour now, and I'll consider that temperature to be settled.
And now let's add some tape to that heatsink to make it less reflective.
So I gave this about 20 minutes to settle, and we got about a degree and a half temperature drop just from putting tape on the heatsink.
And I had to let it settle without me being in the room, because just me moving around it can actually cause some currents, which will cause it to cool down.
And just from walking back and forth in front of it, I saw a temporary temperature drop of almost a degree and a half.
And I let that settle again, and then peel the tape off of it to see if the temperature would rise again.
And I let that settle again with the tape removed, which is here, and the temperature is basically a little bit higher than it was before I put the tape on it. So definitely the tape makes a difference.
And then I set it up vertical, and just with it standing vertical like that, we have better convection on the back, and the temperature dropped by over 2 degrees just from that.
And then I painted the heatsink just with a brown acrylic color, and that dropped the temperature quite a lot because it was wet, but even now it settles at something a little bit lower, so it did help.
But this is all still running without a case, so let's put the case on and see what happens.
So that is taking quite a while to settle, but we have a 7 degree temperature increase from being in the enclosure.
Those plastic enclosures can really trap the heat.
And that's why for my Raspberry Pi computers, rather than an enclosure, I just mount them to a block of wood so they can radiate heat better. And if I'm worried about things falling on them, I sometimes add some screws around it, so if something hits them, it hits those first before it hits the Pi. And looking inside this thing, I've got my painted heatsink now, which does look warm. And we've got some warm components around here, so I think I'm going to drill some holes in the case to allow it to cool better. So let's see if all those perforations made a difference. And so before we're at 42.6, although it was still on the rise and now giving you lots of time to settle, we're at 41.6, so just 1 degree.
Well, that's rather disappointing, but I'm not going to drill any more holes into it, because the more holes, the more likely something gets in there that shouldn't.
I didn't have a good title in mind when I started the video, and afterwards I still didn't have a good title. So I thought, well, let's see what AI suggests. And infrared reveals why the scope runs hot, and my fix barely helped. I guess it's true, but the scope doesn't really run hot. I tried to fix the scope cooling problem, got a surprising result. Is this where people get their video titles from these days, is AI? Thermal pads are way worse than you think. Measured. Actually, I googled these thermal pads. I've only got a tiny bit here. The conductivity is very close to what thermal paste is for mounting heatsinks on CPUs. It's just these things were way thick and now they're half as thick, so that helps a bit. And on a CPU, it's maybe 0.1 millimeters or less, so that helps a lot. But asking AI was useful because it made me think, it's like, hey, I can do better than that. And the tape on the heatsink actually making it run cooler was the most surprising result.
But that's only true if the heatsink is totally reflective, like this piece of aluminum is here, and it's passively cooled, as in no air being blown at it. So for a lot of heatsinks, for instance, this one here is out of a PlayStation 4, and it is also totally reflective, but it doesn't matter because it's inside of an enclosure, and it gets air blown through here, and that's where all the heat goes. It's all conductive, none of it radiated. This heatsink is also reflective. Again, doesn't matter, it's got a fan. These two heatsinks are not reflective, and on this one it would actually help a bit because it will radiate some heat inside the PC. On this one it doesn't matter because it has nowhere to radiate to. For a big passive heatsink like this, being not reflective would help a lot, and I thought, well, this one would do better with some kind of coating on it, but checking it like this, it is reflective, but nowhere near as reflective as this piece of metal is here, so the anodization on this one is thick enough that it's not super reflective in infrared. So for a finned fan-cooled heatsink like this, if the fins did emit infrared, it's just going to get absorbed by the fin right next to it, and that's kind of useless. So you're better off just bare metal and relying on just the air taking away the heat, not radiating it. But for something like this passively cooled Raspberry Pi heatsink case, emissivity does help a lot. And this is one of my Raspberry Pi 4s, and this one does house monitoring, internet serving,
and a bunch of other stuff, and I glued this piece of aluminum on there and painted it for better emissivity, and that keeps it cool enough that it never thermally throttles, although based on my experiments with the scope, I might be better off trying to mount the Pi in this orientation just to have better convection around it, and also get cooling from the back as well. And this video is sponsored by Topdon, who makes a lot of thermal cameras, and I've gotten to like this one more. It's less convenient but good for filming because I get a big screen with it, and when I travel it's handy to have it with me. Because there's been times when I traveled where it's like, damn it, I wish I had my thermal camera with me. Although a funny thing about this one is, right now it's got me right way up, but then when I flip it, it rotates and now I'm upside down. And it took me a while to realize I can just lock the screen rotation, although then of course all the writing is upside down. I used to use this one more, but because this video is sponsored by Topdon, I'm actually not using this one so much because this one was kind of expensive, didn't sell well. So they're not keen on promoting that one. This one is super handy and it's good value for the money. This one's even better value for the money, but having got this one, I don't really have a need to use the one with a smaller screen so much, but this one is a much better deal and it'll tell you what you need to know anyways. And then there is their thermal scope, which is more for outdoors and hunting. Although I've lent it to a friend to check out issues with the church roof just to see if there is water intrusion, if there's signs of that with that. So having telephoto is also useful for actual dealing with buildings kind of thing, where infrared really shines because so many building issues are because of condensation, and condensation happens where temperature is cool and an infrared camera will help you find those spots. And we got Black Friday coming up, so check the video description for promotions that are on right now.